Hello, Bill. How's it going?
It's going well, man. How are you?
Yeah, wicked. My Skype is recording, so should we just jump straight into the
Is it?
conversation?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it.
Awesome. Thanks for taking the time to speak to us today. So,
No worries.
I thought it'd be really interesting for, anybody who's interested to hear about your music career. Clearly it's going really well for you. You're performing all over the world. And so, why don't you give us a rundown? What you've been up to in the last 12 months?
The last 12 months, we've been touring sort of Europe, a bit of America, Australia, Japan, and we got back in September, so we've had a few months off. But yeah, it's been quite flat out, but very enjoyable, and lots of traveling and lots of festivals and stuff. So
So this is with
yeah,
Rag and Bone Man still, yeah?
yes, yeah, with Rag & Bone Man. Yeah, I've been playing with him for about 3 years now.
Right.
And yeah, it's just been a crazy climb, from playing like small festivals where people don't really know who he is to sort of, him exploding and us just going from, small setup to a big setup to big shows. And yeah, it's been great to kind of see his journey and kind of, follow the ride as well. So
So talk
yeah.
us through that whole journey. At what point did you become involved and how did you meet?
Well, I was working with a band called the Hoosiers, which are like a indie rock pop kind of band, and I was working with a guy called Aaron Sayers, who was the tour manager for that band. And about 6 months into touring with them, he just called me up and said he had another artist that was looking for a bass player, and he said that it was Rag and Bone Man, and I had never heard of him at that point. And this was like 3.5 years ago, 3 years ago. And I said I'll check it out, but at the time I was kind of juggling two quite big acts, which was the Hoosiers and Khalees. So I was kind of sort of going between both of them and getting double booked and stuff. So I was kind of going to turn it down, because I didn't know if I could actually have any more on my plate at the time. But he said that this guy's just up and coming, and he's got a lot of stuff in the diary. I said okay, well send me the tracks and I'll have a listen. So he sent them over, and I was like, wow, this guy is super original, and I'm really enjoying his music. And so I called him back and I said, yeah, I'm definitely up for this. When's the first show? And he said, it's in a week and a half. I said, okay, cool. Is there a rehearsal? He said, no, there's no rehearsal, but I'll give you the live CD. You learn the set and you turn up and do the gig and meet everyone on the day. So so that the week and a half was just me spent sort of rehearsing the tunes and listening to in my car and just trying to embed the structures in there. And yeah, so I did that and put in the homework, and then I met everyone on the day at Park Life in Manchester, which was like the festival he was doing a show at. And it was like 9,000 people in this big tent. So yeah, I met everyone on the day and we did the show and it went really well. And yeah, I've been playing with him since then. So it was quite a hectic kind of, right, the gig's next week. Yeah, learn all the stuff. And but yeah, it's a great vibe with them. Everyone's super nice and easy to get on with and fantastic musicians. So it just gelled really well.
That's fantastic. Are you involved in the writing process or do you just play what he writes? It's Rory, isn't it, the guy?
Yeah, Rory Graham. Yeah, we've started to become involved, for this next album, because we kind of joined when that the first album was already sort of being written and produced and stuff. But this next album is going to be a little bit more raw, sort of more live instrumentation. So yeah, so we're sort of currently doing bits and bobs here and there for the next kind of for the next album.
And how do you find it in terms of lifestyle, like being on the road? Do you enjoy it? Like, how often do you get to stop and come home? How does that work?
I really enjoy it, because it's just I'm doing what I love and just sort of playing every other night and traveling. Most of the year we're kind of out for like 10 months, so we come home in, we have like sort of 3 or 4 days here and there to kind of come home, repack and have a breather, and then we'll sort of go out for another 3 months or 2 months or a month. So but yeah, man, it's enjoyable. I mean, it's not for everyone. I know some people that don't take it very easily with, relationships and missing their family and stuff. But yeah, I've settled into it quite well. And yeah, I miss it when I'm home. Like when I'm home, I'm like, oh, you know, can't wait to go back out. So, yeah.
What is it you enjoy? Like, is it the traveling and seeing different places and all the experiences that surround performing, or is it being on stage itself that's the biggest buzz for you?
Yeah, the biggest buzz is actually playing for me. But yeah, the bonus of traveling and seeing new cities that you wouldn't normally see is obviously, yeah, a great thing. And yeah, I think everyone quite enjoys sort of just turning up at a random country and going, wow, I wouldn't actually be here unless I was, you know, getting paid to be here and do a job. It's like, you know, we've been, where have we been? Like random places in Russia. We did a couple of random ones in Russia. We did Tokyo, Canada, Australia. So like just places that I, you know, I would love to go and see, but I probably wouldn't have, you know, unless that we had work booked there. So, yeah.
And are you a kind of person that enjoys being in the limelight, enjoys that lifestyle, the stardom and the fandom and all that side of things? Or is it more like for you, is it more the musicality or is it both?
Yeah, for me, it's more the musicality. You know, I'm a bass player, so I haven't obviously chosen an instrument that, you know, puts me in the limelight in most genres anyway. But yeah, no, I just like sort of playing the music and, you know, I've never wanted to be famous or anything. But, you know, I think established musician is, I'm quite happy with, you know, being labeled as that. But yeah, I think some people, they go into the music industry with, you know, certain goals and stuff. But I think for me, just as a session bass player, I like just turning up, doing my job, enjoying it. And, you know, if people sort of admire you and, you know, I've had a few bass sort of magazine features here and there, which has been really cool. And when I sort of go to like a London bass show, I get recognized through, I think it's mainly through social media. You know, I have an Instagram account that I've been sort of quite active on. So that's kind of helped me get my playing out to different, you know, different areas and different styles and stuff. Mm. But yeah, man, I'm just happy to sort of play, you know. I'm not too fussed about, you know, being famous or being recognized or fans or stuff. I just like playing, so.
it was funny, a while ago, I followed Tony Robbins on Facebook and he posted a photo of a Rag and Bone Man gig and I could see you on stage in the background, so that was cool.
Really?
Yeah, did you not
Where
know
that? Where was that? No, I didn't know that.
I don't know where it was. I guess it was probably in the States. I'm not sure.
Yeah. That's so interesting. Yeah. I know Tony Robbins. Yeah, that's so interesting.
Yeah, that's funny.
Brilliant.
I mean, who's some people that you've met that really stood out? Like,
it's such a blur. Like the last few years, we've definitely met a lot of people that, you know, we've all been starstruck at, but. I think the one that jumps out for me was only like a few months ago, maybe 3 or 4 months ago, we did Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland. And we didn't play it because Rory was ill. So, but we stayed on because we were supposed to play it and it was going to be a big stage and Rory got like a throat infection or something. He had to fly home. But we stayed in Montreux for 3 days and we were up in this VIP bar. Just sat on a table and this guy comes over and says, oh, that's where Quincy Jones sits. And we're like, okay. And they're like, he's like, but don't worry, you know, don't get up. He'll just come sit with you guys. But he sits there every night. And we're like, oh, shit. And we're all there like, what? Is he joking? And 10 minutes later, Quincy Jones comes over and sits with us and starts ordering drinks and chatting to us. And we're there like, what the hell? This is so nuts. So that was like, a kind of like pinch yourself moment where it's like we just sat here having a drink and Quincy Jones has just come and sat with us saying that, you know, he was going to come see the show tonight. But yeah, it was wicked, man. What else? Chad Smith from the Chili Peppers. That was quite cool to meet him. We did Jimmy Fallon over in New York and they have a house band called The Roots, Questlove and all that. Mm. And Chad Smith was like the second drummer. They had like two drum kits set up. So when we did our live performance of Human, They're all there watching us on the side, and we're like, oh God, no pressure, just like all our musical idols is watching us play live on TV, and it's like, this is surreal. So yeah, man, there's been a fair few moments where it's been like, what, how am I in this situation?
And how has Rory found it in terms of how does he find the limelight? Like, does he find that, I mean, does he find that easy to deal with? Does he take it in his stride or what?
Yeah, he takes it in his stride. Like he's quite a shy bloke. He's very down to earth, and he hasn't changed since I met him. He's always been super down to earth and humble, and since getting more and more well known and more famous, like he hasn't changed. So he's still quite shy, and if we do talk shows and stuff, he's quite happy to say no to them. But yeah, man, he's just chilled, and he hasn't changed, which is wicked. Because you'd expect someone to really, most sort of lead singers would get an ego or whatever, but yeah, he hasn't had that, which has been amazing.
Yeah, that's interesting how different people, deal with it and stuff. I'm curious to ask you about your own bass playing. So, how did that start? How old were you?
I was 13 when I started, and it was basically through a friend who was playing guitar, and he'd been playing since he was six, so I was always surrounded by him playing and quite inspired by how good he was at his age. And he would invite me round his house, and he'd play me new music, like new metal stuff, introduce me to that, like Korn, Slipknot, System of a Down, Rage Against the Machine, all that sort of stuff. And then one day he said, oh, he had an older brother that had just bought a bass guitar. And I didn't even know what a bass guitar was. I was very naive to music. And he said, you should go play it. So we went into his room, and it was hanging up, and I picked it up and plugged it into the amp, and tried to make a noise out of it. But as soon as I picked it up, I was just fascinated by how, because I'd kind of dabbled with guitar for a few weeks on his guitar, but I wasn't really inspired by it. I was like, I couldn't really make a decent sound out of it. And when I picked it up, this bass, I was just like, wow, this is so different. And the neck was like really long, and the strings were really thick, and the sound that it made, just I was just like, wow, I need one of these. And I went home and I said to my mum, I was like, I really want a bass guitar. And she said, okay. She said, your birthday isn't until August, and this was like February. I said, can I just have it early and just not have a present in August? And she's like, okay, because I wanted it that bad. I was like, I don't think I can wait. And I was like 12 or 13, so I couldn't really afford to get it myself. And so yeah, and so bought my first bass guitar from Westside in Weston, and it came with like a practice amp and a strap and all that. And yeah, and I was practicing like 4 hours a day for 2 years, before bumping it up to like 6 hours.
Right.
I was obsessed, man. I was like tabs all over my room, like learning every album that I owned, like from start to finish, like. And it was all like heavy stuff, like punk and rock and metal. And when I got into the Chili Peppers when I was like 15 or 16, that was like a whole nother step. And then I started practicing like 6 hours a day, trying to get my playing as close to Flea's as possible, because it was so inspiring. Because I was playing with a pick,
Right.
for a year or so. And then when I discovered the whole fingerstyle thing and the whole slap and all that, yeah, just obsessed with it. So yeah, I put a lot of time into it.
And at
Too much time.
what point did you start performing?
I was actually performing from 14. I was in a band in school, and we were gigging sort of around the southwest, like Exeter, Taunton, Bridgewater, like random places. But we were writing original music. So I was kind of gigging by 14. And yeah, I suppose that really helps, sort of like surrounding myself with musicians that were better than me to kind of up my game. But yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. And also, do you write as well?
I do, yeah, I do. I mean, I've been writing since I was like 16 or 17, but I haven't really prioritized it. I've prioritized gigging with bands, learning set lists, and and in the last 7 or 8 years, doing session work and just trying to, make myself the best bass player I could be for each kind of style. So it hasn't been a priority, but since we've come off tour, like September, I've been like all over writing and co-writing and meeting up with musicians and just sort of, putting your heads together and just sort of coming out with music, because I haven't had that creativity in so long. And we've been touring for 2 or 3 years, and it's nice to finally have a break and just go, oh, right, now I can write some stuff and do something for myself. Mm. I'm currently writing a lot, and I'm looking to release something next year. It's going to be quite a mix of stuff because I can't really stick to one genre.
Right. And is that you singing, or are you collaborating with other people? Or what?
Not singing, no. I will have guest singers because I know a fair few great musicians, and I'd like to sort of, get a few different drummers on the record and a few different guitarists and pianists and vocalists and stuff. So it'll be kind of like a big collaboration of all my favorite musicians and friends and stuff. With like the stuff that I've written, and yeah. So I'm looking forward to getting that kind of going. But at the moment it's sort of, yeah, I'm just sort of working out and getting a feel for my own stuff.
Mm. And will they do the lyrics, or will you write them?
Oh, they'll do the lyrics. Yeah. I'm not very good with lyrics. I would say I'm quite good with writing music and melodies and stuff. So I can write chords, melodies and stuff. But when it comes to vocals and lyrics, I will leave that to someone else. Yeah.
Yeah. I was always the same. I used to play guitar when I was younger, and I never had any aptitude for lyrics or writing, yeah. Really. I mean, I enjoyed playing, yeah. I enjoyed performing, but I don't know, it never seemed to come easily, writing.
Yeah. I think if you put so much into one thing, you really excel at that. Mm. I know a load of musicians that are all rounders, but they're very good at, each instrument, but I think when you put all your time and effort into one instrument, you really excel at that, you know.
Mm. In terms of equipment, what's your bass of choice?
Recently it's been a Fender Precision, but I was playing Warwicks for like 10 years. I was really, really in love with Warwicks, and then maybe in the last 3 or 4 years since I've been playing with Rory, I felt that the Warwicks didn't really suit his sound and his genre. So I've been sort of going between like a Fender Jazz and a Fender Precision, because they're just kind of like, you know, most records are recorded with those basses, and then it's just what it's, they're just easy, you know, you plug them in and they sound exactly what is suited for most things.
Mm.
And with the Precision, you just got a volume and a tone. So with some of the basses, you have millions and millions of tone pots, and it's, you know, you can't really go wrong with just plugging in a Precision and playing it. And you have loads of areas of the fretboard and the pickups to sort of dig in and make different sounds out of.
Mm.
So those two basses have kind of been my main gig and basses over the last 3 or 4 years.
And do you stick to 4 strings, or have you got 5-string basses?
I used to be like strictly 5-string, but I used to play 5-string for like 10 years. And then I went back to 4 just because I picked up a 4 and I was like, well, this is really comfy. And, you know, it's making me play a different way. Whereas if I had a 5-string, it always goes sort of like a lower note. And, you know, I quite enjoyed the way it made me play when I picked up a 4-string, because it was taking me out of my comfort zone, basically. So, yeah, I go between both, but mainly 4-string at the moment, man. Yeah. But it depends on the gig. You know, with Rory, it's 4-string because, I have a lot of, I have like 2 or 3 great effects pedals that can bring me a lower octave. That's just what I'm comfy with at the moment, is just a 4-string. And I'll play a 5 on a gig that's more sort of R&B pop kind of related,
mm.
where it kind of requires that sort of lower B string. But at the moment, yeah, 4.
Yeah. And when you first joined that band, were you straight into having a tech with you?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so we have techs that sort of deal with our gear and set it up and pack it down, and yeah, man, it's a big production. But the first tech I had was with Khalees, and it was very bizarre because I'm so precious with my gear, I'm so used to setting it up and packing it down, and you know, so it was quite bizarre to let someone else handle it. you know, for the first time. I remember on the gig being like watching over him, and he's like, "It's cool, man. It's my job." And I was like, "Yeah, I know. I'm just not used to this." So I remember being like, "Be careful with her. she's worth a lot of money." But yeah, we have techs on the Rag and Bone gig, and yeah, they're amazing. They're really great.
So when you come off stage, you literally just walk off, and that's it. You don't. There's nothing to do.
That's right. Yeah, we do the gig, walk off, and everything is sort of sorted. You know, we'll sound check before the gig. If it's a festival, we won't sound check, and we'll just go in, just go straight on stage, pick up our instruments and play. But if it's like a headline show, we'll sort of make sure everything's cool and our in-ears are sort of like working and all the levels are right. And then, yeah, it's a really nice sort of easy setup.
Has anything crazy or unexpected ever happened at a gig?
I think one time my ears went down, but that was because of a battery issue in my pack. So I remember having to rip my ears out and hear the stage, because we have there's no monitors on stage, and there's all our mix is going straight into our ears, because they try and keep the volume down on the actual stage to keep the PA sort of going. So I remember being like, okay, I have to really remember like where I am and, you know, get a bleed from what Rory's singing. So I think that was the only time I was like, shit.
Right.
But yeah, no, I don't think anything else that I can remember is, I'm sure there's some stories, but I can't really think of anything right now that's a good story or something crazy or unexpected. But yeah, just like a little technical issue, like my battery pack going down.
nothing excessively outrageous then.
No, not yet anyway.
And what kind of transport are you usually doing? Is it buses or planes or what?
Yeah, so it's a mix. If we're doing Europe and stuff, it will be a tour bus. But if we're flying to like Australia, we'll just take a flight there and we'll kind of get like a splitter. But we do buses in the States, you know. If we're doing like 2 or 3 weeks there, then they'll sort a bus out for us when we get there. But yeah, it's like each bus has like 15 beds on it. And it's actually, I actually get a better sleep in that bus than in my own bed, to be honest.
Weird.
Yeah, it's something about like, they're like 7 foot long and 4 foot wide, and you don't feel it. You know, you hear the whirring, like a gentle whirring. And I think that's what I enjoy, is like that consistent sound. So when I go home and I'm actually trying to sleep in my own bed, I need a fan to sort of buzz in the background, because I'm so used to kind of hearing the engine of the bus.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. It's monotonous.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Yeah. It's a mixture of like flights and bus.
What's your favorite recording studio you've been to?
I really like Metropolis in London, because it's like a big old kind of like power station turned into like all these studios. So that's a favorite of mine. And there's one in Bath as well, which is really nice. I think it's Real World.
Oh yeah, you heard of that one? Yeah,
really beautiful, like setting, like it's like just out in the countryside, and it's just, yeah, it's really nice there. But yeah, Metropolis is one of my favourites in London.
Right, and what is it particularly about that?
It's just the vibe of it. It's just like there's 8 or 9 different studios, and they've got like a live to vinyl thing there, which we did, it was about 5 months ago, where we recorded live to vinyl.
Really?
Again, another high pressure situation. But yeah, so we had, we were doing these two tracks, and you get one take and it's recorded straight to vinyl. So it's like, everyone's like, right, don't mess it up.
I don't know enough about that. How come they do that? Is that for DJs, or is it just a novelty thing, or what?
It's like a novelty thing. Yeah, it's like it's what they used to do in, like, you know, in the olden days. I believe. I can't really elaborate too much on it, because I think you'd have to Google it. But yeah, you basically turn up and get all the levels right, and then upstairs they have the vinyl, and they literally you know you're recording, and it's just printing straight to the vinyl. There's no sort of, you know, record it, mix it, and then put it to the vinyl. It's like, get all the levels right, get all the EQ right, and then as soon as you're recording it, just write straight to vinyl. It's really, really interesting. Like, I'd never heard of it before, and when it came in, it was like, right, let's get a rehearsal in then.
I see. So
Yeah.
it ends up sounding more like a live performance than a recorded
That's
one.
right. Yeah. It's like, you know, it's all live. So there's no sort of multi-tracks. There's no overdubs. It's like, you know, you get one take and then it's to the vinyl. And yeah, it's really cool. It's a really interesting process.
And when you end up doing press and stuff, do you get involved with, like, do you end up having to talk on the radio and stuff, or is that, does that just usually Rory doing
No,
it?
that's usually Rory. I mean, because he's the artist, you know, he's the artist. We're like his band. So yeah, he sort of handles all the interviews and stuff. Because it's kind of like, you know, if it was Beyonce, it's like she wouldn't have a band talk, you know, because she's like the artist. So yeah, we just sort of come in and play and do our thing, and yeah, don't get involved with that sort of stuff.
So I guess you're home for Christmas now, are you?
Yeah, I am. Yeah, I've been back for, yeah, so we came back in end of September. So it's been nice kind of doing some local shows and, you know, sort of meeting up with musicians and friends that I haven't seen in a while and sort of make music and stuff. So yeah, home for Christmas, back in Somerset.
What advice would you give to young aspiring musicians? You know, that maybe young teenagers that want to be in a band. What would you say?
I would just say practice as much as you can and just say yes to everything. You know, that's kind of what's worked for me, is just as soon as I sort of moved to Weston, because I was living in Wedmore, I moved to Weston and I went to college there, and I was just basically saying yes to as whatever came my way. I was just saying, yeah, I could do that. I'd love to do that. So I was kind of involved in like seven or eight bands, and even though it was tough sort of juggling them and, you know, getting double booked and sorting out depths and stuff, it was just, I was just involved in as many different musical projects as possible and going between genres and stuff. And I think that way you get more experience, you get your name spread, you know, a bit further. And yeah, I just love playing. So I was just, yeah, I found it very hard to say no to anyone that asked me to do a gig. And I think with, you know, bass players and drummers, you get asked a lot more because there's more guitarists around, you know, than bass players and drummers. And so if you're good at that instrument, then people are going to want you to sort of do something for them. So yeah, my advice really is just sort of just say yes, you know, rather than sort of think twice about it. Just be like, yeah, just get involved and turn up at jam nights and just kind of showcase yourself. And I also think that, you know, I've tried to come off it a little bit, but I think, you know, going back 4 or 5 years ago, social media was really helpful to just kind of promote yourself. Because that kind of got my playing spread out, you know, further than England. And I had a few sort of recording sessions come in through America and through Germany and just random places like that from just a video that I put up on Instagram.
Wow.
So, yeah, I think, you know, a healthy dose of social media kind of is good, you know, from just sort of getting yourself known. And yeah.
I know it's probably a difficult question to answer, but how much of success do you think is attributable just to luck as opposed to preparation and hard work and putting yourself out there? Is there an element of luck?
Yeah, definitely. It's definitely, you know, right place, right time. It's kind of 50-50. You know, you have to be good at what you do, and you have to be, you know, you have to get on with people. But yeah, definitely being at the right place at the right time. You know, because my first like big gig was with Khalees, and the way that happened was so random. So I was doing like a wedding function, and this was about, I think it was like 7 years ago, with a couple of players that I'd never played with before. There's a guy called Danny on drums who I was, you know, been playing with since I was 17 or 18. But there was like three other players on it that I'd never played with. So I learned the set list, turned up, did the gig, and went home. And then 2 weeks later, I had a call from the keyboard player, who was a guy called Pete Yosef. And he called me up and just said, "Hey man, I really liked your playing last week. I've got some gigs that I need you to dep on if you're free." He said, "One's in Budapest and one's in Brussels, and they're festival gigs." And I was like, cool. "What's the band, the artist?" And he said, "It's for an R&B singer called Khalees." And I was like, "Oh, right. Wow. Okay. Thanks, man. Like, just wasn't excited. And I only met him like last week, and he just offered that to me and said, "Yeah, I'd like you to cover them. I really liked your playing and I liked your attitude." And I was like, "Wow." So yeah, that just came out of like a random wedding gig. So it's like most people would turn up and go, "Oh, it's just another wedding gig," and not think anything would come from it. But I think having the attitude of just sort of, turning up to a gig and playing it as best as you can, because you never know who's listening or watching, or, even if it's like a little pub gig or a wedding function or a corporate event, just play as well as you can, because yeah, you just don't know who's going to pick you up and offer you something decent.
What do you get up to outside of music? Have you got other interests and hobbies?
I don't, man. It's literally music. Like, as soon as I come home, I'm just practicing. So I'm either listening or playing. I should, probably should get back into sports or something a bit more active. But yeah, I'm just, yeah, I'm always playing and always listening. I think, yeah, it's like an endless journey, really.
Go on.
No, that was it, man. Yeah, I just,
Okay.
yeah, it's, yeah.
Yeah, fair.
I used to be really into sports. I used to be really into like football and stuff, and I used to go to the gym quite a bit. So I was obsessed with fitness for a few years. But then I realized that I was more obsessed with fitness than music. So I was like, hang on a sec, I'm not going to make money from fitness. I need to get back into, having that love for music. Because I think when you go to the gym, and yourself, you put everything into it, and you wake up thinking about nutrition, you go to sleep thinking about lifting and stuff. So like with my personality, if I get into something, I really get into it. Like, I don't do it like a half a job. I'm like, right, I'm now obsessed with this. So
Yeah, I can relate to that. I think I'm similar to
man.
that. But it's true though, you really got to commit a lot of time to something in order to master it, haven't you?
Yeah, exactly. And like when you've got a certain personality, you will do that, because you go, I'm not gonna do this half-assed. I'm gonna get the best I can out of it. So at the moment, I'm just sort of sticking with music and enjoying that, and still excited very much by each and every genre and everything new that comes along.
When you were young, did you always have like a long-term vision? Did you always want to be successful, or did you see yourself as being successful, or were you more just in the moment doing what you enjoyed and just focusing on the task at hand?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't really know what I wanted to do until I did pick up the bass at 13. I was playing football quite a bit and I was enjoying that. But when someone said to me or asked me the question, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" I don't know, but it hit me when I literally picked up the bass. I was like, now I know what I want to do. And I was quite competitive with it, I did. There was this guy that was, we had two bass players in our music class of about 30 or 40, and he was really good. And I remember being like, "Oh, this guy's better than me," and it made me want to practice more, because I was like, not only was I already excited by the instrument, but I was like, now I, this guy is, seen as the best bass player, and I was like, I want to be better than him. So I just practiced my ass off, and yeah. So yeah, there was a tiny competitive element to that when I was younger, but like since then, I now I've stopped being competitive with it. I just love it, and I know I'm not the best bass player in the world, but I'm very happy with like my playing, like where it's got to, and the type of genres that I can sort of do. But yeah, man.
From a technical standpoint, who are the bass players that you admire or look up to? Who are your bass heroes?
Well, my first like bass hero that really gave me a push was Flea, and I think he's very underrated. A lot of people go, "Oh, Flea." It's like, no, actually, listen to this guy. Listen to like Blood Sugar Sex Magik. That album is just, the bass playing on it is phenomenal. And that was what really gave me a push, that and Californication. So my first real like bass idol would be Flea. And do you know what? I still put a lot down to him, even though he's not really that talked about in the bass world anymore. Like, he has still, done some amazing work and inspired a lot of players. But nowadays it's more like guys like Victor Wooton, Jaco Pastorius, Marcus Miller. Those were like the big three that took it from, you know, the Flea kind of style playing to a whole nother level. But with them, it's like they're seen as very, very technical players. But when they groove, they have amazing time feel. They have amazing pocket. And I think a lot of people forget that with the technical players. They also have this, you know, great foundation of groove and can play for the song rather than just sort of being, you know, pyrotechnics and flashy.
It's funny, when I used to play guitar, I was in a Chili Pepper tribute band for a bit. It's a shame because we weren't that good. But
really?
Not really. I mean, I had the desire and the ambition to want to do it, but we weren't that type. And it's funny, like hearing you talk about it, I didn't realize Flea was an influence of your, like, you know, the Chili Peppers. It's funny because if we'd have probably known each other when we were a lot younger, we'd have probably collaborated on something.
I reckon so. Yeah.
But I've long
that would have been fun, man. I've done a lot of tribute bands, but Chili Peppers was the one I definitely haven't done and would have definitely said yes to.
We were called the Red Hot Silly Feckers.
And nice.
We had a good name, but that was about it.
And, fair play, man. That must have been fun.
It was fun. We were doing student unions, which, of course, you know, you've been there and done it all. But because they're quite often, you know, when they do freshers balls or graduation balls, they're usually like quite a big event in a big hall or something. So it's like it was nice. You know, I enjoyed the whole thing of being on a decent stage with a proper sound system and all that.
Yeah, man. Nice experience. Are you still playing?
No, I haven't. The last gig I did was 2006. So
right.
Like, what is that now? That's 13 years ago almost.
I've seen your playing, man. You're a very good guitarist and bassist. You know, I'd give you a gig. Yeah.
Well, I could blag my. Yeah, I was all right. I was rock blues. I was never as technical or as fast as I wanted to be, but I was okay.
You don't need to be though, man. Like, people aren't looking for that. They're just looking for someone who's solid. Got feel, a little bit chops, you know, which you can do. That's all people need really in the music industry is just, you know, someone who can play tight, play the songs, play the parts, and just groove with the other musicians.
I could pretty much get away with that, but
I wouldn't rule it out.
And what happened was around about 2006-2007 I made an online guitar lesson website. That was okay. I ran it for a couple of years, and eventually I got myself in a mess and ran into problems with the royalties, and I kind of gave up because it was too stressful. But it was okay. And then after that, I just got into fitness and handstands, and, you know, just went off in a different direction.
Yeah, man. That's great. As long as you're sort of you've got that obsession with something, it's like, you know, you're going to get to a certain level with it, and but you still got that, man. You still got that. I'm sure you've still got that in your hands, you know, the playing. I'm sure it's still there.
Yeah, I occasionally pick it up, but very rarely. Yeah. It's really weird. I don't know how you experience it. It sounds like you've got a much healthier relationship with the lifestyle of performing and stuff. But when I used to play, I was one of those people. I'd come off stage and I'd feel miserable and really down. I don't know. Do you ever get that or not?
No, not really. I know people that do, though. I know people that quite hard on themselves, and, you know, if they make like a tiny mistake, they'll beat themselves up about it, but it's usually something that no one else notices, you know. It's usually something that only you will notice, and you'll be super critical of your playing. But it's so common, man, and I don't think it's a bad thing to be, because it's only going to make you, you know, better. But I suppose it's the level of, oh shit, you know, oh, I don't like my playing, or, you know, I suppose it's how far you go with it. You know, some people will sort of go, oh, that's just going to make me, you know, get better or practice harder. But it's very common, man, with musicians.
Yeah, I see. Yeah, I've heard comedians say the same thing. You know, it's almost like a high to a low kind of thing, like one extreme to the other. But I don't know what the answer to is with that, but I didn't quite find my stride with it. You know, but you know, it's okay. Bill, I really appreciate you taking the time to speak to us.
No worries, man, it's been a pleasure.
Have you got any final comments or words of wisdom before we wrap up?
Well, if it's for musicians, just practice. Yeah, that's all I really have to say. It will get you to a place that, you know, you want to get to. So put the time in and you'll get it back. kind of thing.
Where can people find you? Website and Instagram?
Yeah, I'm on Instagram, Bill underscore Banwell. I have a website which is billbanwell.com, and I have a YouTube which is Bill the Bass 88. So
Okay.
yeah, videos are on there and stuff. So
Awesome.
yeah.
All right then, Bill. It's been really fun talking to you. Thank you.
Yeah, cheers, Ben.
All
Take
right.
care, man.
Bye for now. Bye.
Bye, bye, bye.